Phoenix Books presents The Adventures of Brother Cadfael, a collection of Cadfael chronicles including Monk's Hood, St. Peter's Fair, The Heretic's Apprentice, The Potter's Field, The Summer of the Danes, and Brother Cadfael's Penance, written by Ellis Peters. These performances by Sir Derek Jacobi are copyright 2014 Phoenix Books and are digitally remastered from the original 1997 Dove Audio sound recordings. Monk's Hood, the Third Chronicle of Brother Cadfael.
In this particular morning, at the beginning of December, in the year 1138, Brother Cadfael came to chapter in tranquility of mind, prepared to be tolerant even towards the dull pedestrian reading of Brother Francis. The year, so stormy in its earlier months, convulsed with siege and slaughter, bade fair to end in calm and comparative plenty. The tide of civil war between King Stephen and the Empress Maud had receded into the southwestern borders, leaving Shrewsbury to recover cautiously from having backed the weaker side and paid a bloody price for it. And for all the hindrances to good husbandry, after a splendid summer, the harvest had been successfully gathered in, the barns were full, the mills were busy, sheep and cattle thrived, and the weather continued surprisingly mild. And in his own small kingdom, the crop had been rich and varied. The eaves of his workshop were hung everywhere with linen bags of dried herbs. His jars of wine sat in plump, complacent rows. The shelves were thronging with bottles and pots of specifics for all the ills of winter. It was a better world than it had looked in the spring, and an ending that improves on its beginning is always good news. So Brother Cadfael strolled contentedly to his chosen seat in the chapter house, conveniently retired behind one of the pillars in a dim corner, and watched with half-sleepy benevolence as his brothers took their places. Abbot Heribert, old and gentle and anxious, sadly worn by the troublous year. Prior Robert Pennant, immensely tall and patrician, ivory of face and silver of hair and brows, ever erect and stately, as if he had already balanced the mitre for which he yearned. Faithful, at his heels, slid Brother Jerome, his clerk, reflecting Robert's pleasure or displeasure like a small, warped mirror. After them came all the other officers, to decorously compose themselves for what bade fair to be an unremarkable day's business. Brother Paul, master of the novices, had a complaint against one of his pupils, in that the youngster had been heard singing in the cloisters while he was employed in copying a prayer of St. Augustine, a secular song of scandalous import, purporting to be the lament of a Christian pilgrim imprisoned by the Saracens and comforting himself by hugging to his breast the chemise given him at a parting by his lover. Brother Cadfael's mind jerked him back from incipient slumber to recognize and remember the song, beautiful and poignant. He had been in that crusade. He knew the land, the Saracens, such a prison and such a pain. As consternation quivered through several of the old, innocent, lifelong brothers, to whom half the creation was a closed and forbidden book, Cadfael asked mildly what defense the youth had made. "He said," Brother Paul replied fairly, "that he learned the song from his grandfather, who fought for the cross at the taking of Jerusalem, and he found the tune so beautiful that it seemed to him holy. For the pilgrim who sang was not a monastic or a soldier, but a humble person who made the long journey out of love." "A proper and sanctified love," pointed out Brother Cadfael, using words not entirely natural to him, for he thought of love as a self-sanctifying force, needing no apology. "And is there anything in the words of that song to suggest that the woman he left behind was not his wife? I remember none. And the music is worthy of noting. It is not, surely, the purpose of our order to obliterate or censure the sacrament of marriage for those who have not a celibate vocation. I think this young man may have done nothing very wrong. Should not Brother Precentor try if he has not a gifted voice? Those who sing at their work commonly have some need to use a God-given talent." Friar Robert frowned down his patrician nose, but the master of novices was content to have a good construction put on his pupils' laps. The singer got away with a light penance. Abbot Heribert, always inclined to be lenient, this morning appeared more than usually preoccupied and rose as if to put an end to the chapter. "There are documents to be sealed," said Brother Matthew, the cellarer, in haste. "I have not forgotten." Abbot Heribert looked small, dignified but resigned, standing before them with a scroll of his own gripped in both hands. "There is something I have to announce to you all. These necessary documents cannot be sealed today. It may well be that I no longer have the right to conclude any agreement for this community. I have here an instruction delivered to me from Westminster, from the King's Court. You all know that Pope Innocent has acknowledged King Stephen's claim to the throne of this realm, and in his support has sent over a legate with full powers, Alberic, Cardinal Bishop of Ostia. The Cardinal proposes to hold a legatine council in London for the reform of the Church, and I am summoned to attend, to account for my stewardship as abbot of this convent. The terms make clear," said Heribert, firmly and sadly, "that my tenure is at the disposal of the legate. We have lived through a troubled year and been tossed between two claimants to the throne of our land. It is not a secret, and I acknowledge it, that His Grace, when he was here in the summer, held me in no great favor, since, in the confusion of the times, I did not see my way clear and was slow to accept his sovereignty. Therefore, I now regard my abbacy as suspended until, or unless, the Legatine Council forms me an office. I cannot ratify any documents or agreements in the name of our house. Whatever is now uncompleted must remain uncompleted until a firm appointment has been made." He resumed his seat and folded his hands patiently, while their bewildered, dismayed murmurings gradually congealed and mounted into a boiling bee's hive hum of consternation. Though not everyone was horrified, as Cadfael plainly saw. Prior Robert, just as startled as the rest and adept at maintaining a decorous front, nonetheless glowed brightly behind his ivory face, drawing the obvious conclusion. And Brother Jerome, quick to interpret any message from that quarter, hugged himself with glee inside the sleeves of his habit, while his face exhibited pious sympathy and pain. Not that they had anything against Heribert, except that he continued to hold an office on which impatient subordinates were casting covetous eyes. But the rest of them fluttered and panicked like hens invaded by the fox. Brother Matthew shuffled his parchments and pondered, shaken by the suddenness of the news. "Father Abbot, there is here no reason for hurry, except in the matter of the guestship agreement with Gervaise Bonnel and his wife. Master Bonnel relies on the charter being sealed very soon." "Remind me of the terms, if you will," the abbot requested apologetically. "My mind has been full of other matters." "Why, he grants to us his manor of Mallely, absolutely, with his several tenants, in return for a message here at the abbey. The first house on the town side of the mill pond is vacant, and the most suitable to his household, together with keep for life, for himself and his wife, and for two servants also. The details are as usual in such cases. I had intended to have witnesses come hither after chapter for the ratification. The justice has a clerk waiting." "I fear nonetheless," said the abbot heavily, "that this must wait." "It will inconvenience Master Bonnel," said the cellarer anxiously. "They have already prepared to remove here, and expected to do so in the next few days. The Christmas feast is coming, and they cannot well be left in discomfort." "Surely," suggested Prior Robert, "the move could be countenanced, even if the ratification must wait a while. It's highly unlikely that any abbot appointed would wish to upset this agreement." Heribert jumped at the suggestion. "I think such a move is permissible. Yes, Brother Matthew, you may proceed, pending final sanction. There is no other case needing attention?" None, Father. And he asked, subdued.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.